The only way that you can legitimize your claim or that they can be taken seriously by other people is if you provide the evidence or the literature that supports it. So you have to further demonstrate the gap that we are looking at. And sometimes these gaps are also based on logical extension. What sort of research method are you going to use? And what is your research logic? What contribution are you making to theory? Are you extending or validating a particular theory? Are you challenging theory? Are you building new theory? I'm Dr. Nonichi Extra. If you like what you see, follow, like, subscribe, and share. Happy writing. This is a follow-up on a video that I made on writing the introduction for an academic paper or dissertation. In that video, I discussed the contents of an introduction and the structure. In this video, I'm going to extend this and discuss the types of literature that you are expected to use in your introduction and for what purpose. The four main things that your introduction section is going to have is, first of all, a brief description of what the problem is and why it is important, whether from a theoretical or practical viewpoint, usually both. You will also have to spend some time on disclosing the state of the art. So what's currently known, what's the current status of knowledge, and how therefore does it lead to a gap or a shortcoming in the literature that you're going to address. You also have to spend a bit of time in the introduction disclosing the methods that you are going to use. And then finally, usually you will say something about the contribution that you make with your work. So for each of these four things, there are different types of literature that you have to use in order for your introduction to be at least distinction level. In order to legitimize your work, you have to make sure that your claims about the nature of the problem and why it is important are backed up by evidence from trusted sources. Typically, this will be peer-reviewed literature from a reputable source. It could also be information that's coming out from a think tank or some kind of statistics body that captures the key information highlighting the importance of this issue. So the only way that you can legitimize your claim or that they can be taken seriously by other people is if you provide the evidence or the literature that supports this. And as I have already said, this literature needn't be the literature in the traditional sense from peer-reviewed journals. Sometimes it comes from think tanks. Sometimes it's an uncontested statistic. So once you have done this, you have legitimized the problem that you are claiming is important, and you have demonstrated why it will be relevant to explore from either a theoretical or practical viewpoint. The second issue relates to what you consider to be the state of the art. So you have to further demonstrate the gap that we are looking at. And in order to do that, you have to show what's the latest knowledge on this. So it helps to look at usually literature reviews because they're going to provide an overview of the knowledge up to a certain point. And they're also going to provide directions for future research. It could be that there's a recent publication that points to a major shortcoming in the existing literature so that can become the basis for what you would like to do. And sometimes these gaps are also based on logical extensions. So as an example, I study supply chains and we have talked for many years about supply chain resilience, but there's a body of literature that comes up that shows that even though we discuss supply chain resilience, most of the studies that we have conducted, empirical studies, have looked at diets or single organizations, and therefore we are actually yet to understand supply chain resilience in the real sense. So even though there is limited literature that will point to this flaw, it is easy to point to the existing body of literature and show that the level of analysis has not really been extended to the supply chain level, and therefore there is a gap to be explored. So in order to show that there's a gap, there's a real gap in terms of what you are saying, you can rely on literature reviews, you can rely on the most recent work and their claims about that, or you can do it by logical extension by pointing at the current body of literature and showing why there's an obvious flaw in terms of the knowledge as we have it right now. Once you have pointed to the gaps, you are going to come up with a clear research question. Usually helps to have a research question explicitly put in the introduction. And then on the basis of this research question, you are going to have to spend a bit of time disclosing your approach. So in particular, what sort of research method are you going to use and what is your research logic? For this, what the goal is to show that the methods that you have chosen fits the question that you are asking. So, for example, if you're asking how and why questions, then it naturally follows that you are going to be looking at typically qualitative case studies. And once you actually point to these case studies, you have to point to the literature that justifies the use of this approach for the type of question and setting that you have chosen. And then the next thing relates to the research logic. Essentially, what contribution are you making to theory? Are you extending or validating a particular theory? Are you challenging theory? Are you building new theory? And then this research logic, you also have to show that it fits the current knowledge and what you have identified as current gaps, and that the method that you have chosen is going to be useful for achieving this. So this is one of the only instances that I can think of when you are doing an empirical piece of work where you have to spend some time explicitly addressing theory. So how your work fits in the wider body of knowledge that gives us explanations for phenomena and that predicts what will happen in a given setting relating to a particular phenomenon. Finally, you have to spend some time on disclosing your contribution, and it helps if you also show that this contribution is meaningful relative to existing knowledge. So what new insights do you provide as a result of your own process? This means that you will have to, for example, point to literature that has explicitly said that this type of work is important, so show that others have called for it. Sometimes you're also showing that your work goes a bit further than others have gone before, and having justified this with the state of the art, usually you don't need to do more work in that area. So the contribution also sometimes, the level to which you're going to bring in literature depends on how much you unpacked when you presented the state of the art, but it helps typically to point to at least to a few bits of literature that show that what you claim to be contribution is indeed contribution. So that's relative to the knowledge that we currently have or relative to previous calls for the type of work that you have undertaken. So it usually helps to also look at the limitation sections of other researchers who have done similar work, because there they might already explicitly point to the types of future contributions that are needed, and therefore you can position your work relative to those pre-identified and pre-acknowledged research gaps. So the next time that you have to write an introduction, remember the different bits of literature that you need to present within this section. You need, first of all, the literature that is going to legitimize your claims about a problem, why it is important, whether it's from a theoretical or practical viewpoint. You also need literature that demonstrates that the gap that you claim exists does exist. And then you are also going to need literature that is going to show that for whatever research question that you come up with relative to the gap or shortcomings that you have identified, you have to show that the method that you have chosen fits the question. So you have to refer to the method's literature that justifies the chosen method for that particular question. You also have to spend a bit of time, at least a couple of sentences, talking about your research logic, which is what do you intend to do in terms of theory, relative to theory? Are you extending the theory or are you building new theory? And why does this fit the type of question and gaps that you have identified? And finally, you have to present some literature that shows that your contribution is one that is also valid. So have there been previous researchers calling for the type of work that you are doing to be done, or is there a gap that you have identified and convinced others of, and therefore show that by extending the work in the way that you have, you provide new, fresh insights or more in-depth insights on regarding a particular phenomenon. I'm Dr. Nonichi Extra. If you like what you see, follow, like, subscribe, and share. Happy writing.
That I think Alice.